One legendary voice has welcomed millions of fans to the WWE on Monday nights for over a decade.
We are live in New York City, and this is Monday Night Raw.
When you hear Jim Ross, you know you've got it on the right channel. You're watching the right program.
Thank you so much, folks, for inviting us into your homes.
Jim is like the John Madden of WWE.
There is no one in the history of wrestling that's been able to call a big-time main event match like Jim Ross.
And folks, this is what our business is all about.
He just has that ability to connect with our fans.
JR makes you hurt, makes you cry, makes you yell.
Oh, yeah!
You can tell that everything he says truly comes from his heart.
There's nobody that I would rather have call on my match than Jim Ross.
You feel his passion for this business.
The passion comes through because it's genuine.
We're asking you to feel this and be a part of something this special.
His voice is plastered on so many great moments over the years.
You can feel his emotion and you get caught up in his emotion.
Cena has walked through hell.
He can't contain it.
The show-stopping spirit of Shawn Michaels lives.
He's got an amazing gift.
A lot of people are good, but very few people get great. He's great.
Him doing announcing is what he was put on earth for.
God, I love this job!
I've often heard Jim say, you know, well, Gordon Solie was the best. And I'll look Jim Ross right in the eye and tell him you're as good as Gordon Solie ever was.
But there's just nobody better than Jim Ross.
Austin and the champion!
He's the best ever in the story.
Good old JR, Jim Ross!
How's it going, everybody? Bryan Alvarez and Dave Meltzer here on Wrestling Observer Radio. Breaking news audio this afternoon on the retirement, they are saying, of Jim Ross. And Dave, you've written a little bit about this on the front page. What's going on?
Well, I mean, it stems from what happened at the 2K Sports Symposium in late August in Los Angeles. I guess the key thing... It had been, I mean, from literally the minute the thing ended, there was talk of this, and I had certainly heard that, and we had actually discussed it, I think, the next morning. And then, you know, not hearing anything for 3 weeks, I figured it had blown over. And then, the rumors started going, and last night I had a conversation with somebody who noted to me that JR was in Connecticut, and that nobody knew what was going on except for, like, maybe three people, which I'm guessing would be Vince, Paul and Stephanie, and everybody was thinking that this was it. And in the course of the conversation, as with, you know, the funny part of it was that I had heard rumors during the week as well, but you know, this was like pretty adamant that there was a not, and then and again, like when I tell you that the person didn't know, I mean literally didn't know, but we were certainly talking about it like it was a strong possibility. And Bryan and I actually have talked about it this week as well, and that is that it would have to they couldn't say, you know. From a PR standpoint, you know, the way I was thinking about it and is that they couldn't say that they were terminating him over the thing that happened it was over the behavior of Ric Flair and Jim Ross not reeling him in and this not following the script at the symposium, which was actually a 2K event and not even a WWE event. But the feeling was that Jim Ross was the representative of the WWE, and they were very unhappy with the way that thing went. And the funny part, of course, is has come out, is that 2K was actually thrilled because it got way more publicity than it would have, and they thought it was way more entertaining, and that the actual, you know, stuff until Rick went off, there were, you know, a lot of the people in the audience thought it was kind of like this boring robotic thing. And then when Rick went off, it was kind of like people thought it was like this fun thing, you know, even though it was, the company had its idea of what it wanted and it wasn't what turned out. And the key thing was, is when it was a tough thing, because the one that apparently got the most heat was Rick talking about Reed, you know, the death of Reed, which they didn't want. And that's one where it's really hard. I mean, I, you know, I've talked to a couple people today about this and like that actually had seen it. And, you know, the feeling was, is like, exactly what could, now Jim Ross could have perhaps, like, you know, pulled away from Rick, and asked somebody else a question, you know, broken in on him while he was all long winded. I think there would have been people who wouldn't have liked it and would have thought that he was rude to do it, but he could have done it. And I think that that's one of the things that they weren't happy with.
Let me jump in here for a second.
Okay.
Because I watched the whole thing. This whole thing pisses me off.
Okay.
So, listen, there was no problem until about 50 minutes in. And the first guy that went off script, and he didn't even do it on purpose, was Mick Foley.
Well, you know what's funny is that somebody had told me when we were discussing this, the actually brought up that, you know, this all started with Mick Foley. And it's like, yeah, I guess you could say that. But
hold on. When Mick Foley went off script, on accident, mind you.
Yeah, because he didn't know what was going on.
Okay, the very first thing was Jim Ross telling this guy to knock it off, we've got a script. And he was actually, I don't know if he was really rude about it, but him and Steve Austin got in Mick Foley so bad for going off script that Mick Foley stood up and faked like he was going to walk out. That's number one.
I want to mention one thing also real quick on this. Jim Ross did have a script, but nobody else had a script.
Okay.
Nobody else knew what was going on. There wasn't like it was a production meeting. It wasn't like Ric Flair or Steve Austin or Mick Foley had any clue what was going to be asked.
Okay.
Jim Ross did have a script, and these were the questions he was supposed to ask, and he was doing that until, you know, Mick Foley, I guess, didn't go off script, but Mick Foley didn't understand why they were ignoring Ric Flair.
Yes.
And that led to Ric Flair starting to talk and not stopping to talk for a long time.
Okay, so again, Foley goes off script. Ross immediately tried to reel him back in, which they were very firm trying to reel him back in. So then Flair starts going off, and Flair is talking about his son who died.
Yes.
How the hell are you going to jump in and say, Flair, hold on a second, we don't care about Reed right now. We're here talking about WrestleMania memories. Let's not bring up your son, who's dead, who you're here crying about and telling this story. I mean, no one in their right mind would have jumped into Ric Flair to cut him off right there. That would have come off so poorly. And then the last thing is, on top of all this, when, keep in mind, Jim Ross did keep trying to jump in and Rick just steamrolled him every single time. So finally, I don't know if people even remember this, but Paul Heyman went up and he went over and he ripped up Jim Ross's script.
Yes.
Because everybody on the panel realized it's off the rails. Nobody's going to bring it back. You can't stop Flair unless you physically drag him off the stage. I didn't see Stephanie coming in and physically dragging Flair off the stage. They did that when the thing was over. They let the thing go on until it was over, and then they dragged the guy off the stage. And Jim Ross gets the heat for all of this. What the hell did you expect Jim Ross to do?
I'm not defending their point of view.
And he tried.
Because I mean, here's the thing. I watched it too, and you know, I mean, my thought was, and I, you know, believe me, I heard from so many different people on all sides, and I mean, I don't want to say the only people who were upset were Vince and Stephanie and Michelle Wilson, because I'm sure that's not true, but you know, I didn't really hear of anyone else. I think that most people just kind of saw it for what it was. Some thought, well, you know, shouldn't have happened, but no, I don't think anyone considered it like an embarrassment to the company, but they did. They had this idea of this was going to be guys being asked questions about your favorite WrestleMania match and your, you know, the standard things. And Ric Flair, who, you know, in his mind, Rick was there telling a story to put the company over. You know, the story was that when Reed died, he took his ring. His WWE, you know, he's got two WWE Hall of Fame rings. He's got the one from herself and the one from the Horseman. So he gave one of his rings and he put it on Reed's hand or on his finger in the casket, which was quite a sad story. But, you know, the whole point of the story was he did that. And then not to play favorites because he has two boys, he gave the other one to David, his other son. And the story was is that, you know, when Paul found out that, you know, whatever, that Paul and WWE gave him another ring for himself. And so he's telling the story, which actually puts the company over, but they were upset because, you know, it was something, it was supposed to be an upper, and talking about the death of Ric Flair was such a downer. And, I mean, it's what happened, but, I mean, again, Rick didn't know. I mean, Rick, you know, I mean, that's the craziest thing of the whole thing is in Rick's mind, he was putting over the company. Now, you know, then he kept going with the other stories, with the drinking stories of John Cena and all that. And, you know, obviously, you know, I mean, when we talked about the whole thing, it's like, I, you know, we both kind of knew that this was a bigger deal than it should have been because of, you know, the portrayal that John Cena drinks a lot, because that's not the portrayal that they want, because their whole thing is the guys don't drink anymore. They play their video games afterwards. It's a different generation. It's not that old time wrestling thing. And here's Rick talking about the biggest star in there, you know, the guy, the clean face of the company, John. You know, it could be if he talked about, like, you know, someone who played a wild gimmick, perhaps, you know, they wouldn't have been so upset. And if it was a lower rated guy on the show, but this is John, this is their kid's hero. And he's talking about this and, you know, it was something that they didn't want. And, you know, then he's talking about his own drinking stories and.
All right. So that's the end of Ric Flair. If you're going to fire Jim Ross, why don't you fire Paul Heyman while you're at it? He ripped the script up. Why don't you fire Steve Austin, who was laughing about it and egging Flair on, and then took him into his hotel and did a three-hour podcast the next day?
Steve Austin was egging Flair on, you're right, and that's right, and promoted the podcast the next day and talked about them drinking and doing the podcast.
In fact, of everybody on that goddamn stage, the one guy who was trying to get the train back on the tracks was Jim Ross.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah, I think so. I mean,
I didn't see anybody else trying to reel Flair in.
It wasn't as if, you know, Rey Mysterio or Bryan Danielson or any of those guys were jumping in.
No, they all laughed.
Yeah.
They either laughed or they egged him on. And the one guy that tried to bring this train back onto the track is the one that's done.
Yeah. Well, I don't know what to say, because like I said, when I first heard about it, it was Sunday morning, I think it was. And, well, I've heard about Saturday night, but where I first heard about, I mean, I heard that what happened Saturday night, and Sunday morning, you know, I had started getting calls from people saying that there's, like, it's a really intense thing. This is really a bad deal. The company's really upset. And I was like, oh, man, it sounds bad. And then I talked to you, you know, on when we talked about SummerSlam. You were kind of telling me, and that's why I kept asking you questions. I hadn't seen it yet. And after talking to you, it was like, okay, I kind of had an idea what happened. And you actually were the most rational of anyone that night, because I'm asking you these little points, and you didn't even think that they were all that big. And then, you know, later people are going like, oh, my God, you know, it was horrible. It was terrible. So then I watched it finally, and it was just like it was so much less than it had been built up to me, so to speak. But whatever. I mean, it's like I absolutely saw, you know, I'm watching it with this idea, you know, of not watching it for my own entertainment, but I'm watching, okay, what got Stephanie and Michelle Wilson and Vince McMahon so mad? And I could see, you know, I didn't think the Reed thing would be one of them, which was funny because that's what I was told was the one that really got them. I thought it was the Cena thing, and I understood it. At the same time, the idea that as far as not signing, you know, pulling Rick from the, you know, the media stuff after pulling Rick from the show, because Rick was supposed to be on SummerSlam, not making a deal with Rick that was, you know, they were there to make a deal. I expected all that. I mean, like, I expected all that because of all that heat. You know, yeah, I was like, they're going to pull Rick from the show for sure. And they're probably not going to make the deal. Whatever the deal is that they were negotiating, they're probably not going to make that deal. I did expect that. I don't know if it was the right move, you know, because I don't know. But as far as, like, you know, the Jim Ross stuff, it was like, I was kind of like, but why? And then it, like I said, you know, then a couple weeks went by and didn't hear anything. And it was just like, okay, you know, nothing's going to happen. And then, you know, it happened. But, I mean, the whole deal as far as, you know, the retirement was a way because they didn't want to say, you know, it's basically going to create what it's going to create anyway, because we're bringing it up. And it was one of those things where, you know, when I woke up this morning, it was like, the thing was, it's like, this is going to be one of those days. And I've had more than one of those this week. I've had three of those this week where I'm writing a story, or which I expect, because I expected this to happen, but I didn't know for sure. But I certainly did expect it. I'm writing a story, and everyone's going to deny it, even though 100% I know that it's right. And it's not like 100% I'm speculating that's right. This is the story. And no one's going to want, you know, the whole idea of the way it was portrayed was to avoid this and, you know, whatever. But that's the deal. Because the one thing, you know, again, Jim Ross is a very popular personality with the fans, and the idea that he gets fired over this is going to cause the uproar, which is exactly what they didn't want. So they had Jim do the, you know, the PR thing, which is to announce that he's retiring to go to do personal endeavors, which, if you remember, Brian, on Monday, I pretty much, you know, I had talked to Brian about this earlier in the week because I had this premonition this was all happening. And, you know, I said, like, and again, nobody told me this. It was like, this is how it's going to go down. And it pretty much went down exactly like I told you, didn't it?
Yep.
Yeah. But, As far as, if you look at it, it's like, one of the things about it, and, you know, one of the things about it was when it kind of was getting out, a lot of people knew the speculated story. Nobody knew the story. But when this is happening, I kept thinking that it's like, you know, at the end of the day, this isn't going to happen. Even though the evidence was there, especially when Tuesday night someone had told, you know, calls me and says, Jim Ross is in Stanford. And it's like, wow, well, you know, that isn't good. But, you know, the whole thing is like the, you know, I kept thinking like, really think about it. I saw the thing. It's like, again, you start thinking about, like, you know, he's got a lot of value as far as the developmental program. You know, he the different things that he's been involved. I mean, he's really been hands-on with that developmental program working with Triple H.
Well, let me just jump in and say that he did a speaking tour in Manchester 2 weeks ago. This is from Steven. And he specifically said, no intention of retiring, loves his role, loves working with developmental and at the NXT TV tapings.
Well, I bet. He and they wish that he never said that.
Well,
at that time, I'm guessing that, you know, I don't know. I mean, I don't know what he would have known, but, you know, whatever. There you go. But I just kept thinking between that, and the other thing is that with a network coming, and believe me, you know, this has only happened over, you know, it's only happened a couple hours ago, and there's already like this feeling of like, you know, you know, he'll be back in 6 months, you know, because
that's my feeling.
You know, I mean, when the network comes, it's like, how many people do they have that can do lead ins, lead outs, do those kind of shows with the old time guys that really would have the working knowledge of the whole wrestling world, you know, all the territories and all that. I mean, there are a handful of guys who could do it, but not too many. I don't see, and he would be the, you know, and here's the other one. It's like, you know, do voiceovers. Here's another thing. You know, I mean, Ross was doing the, you know, whenever they do the old time stuff with on 2K in the video game. I mean, Ross was a key part of that video game every year, you know, and this year as well, announcing the matches and things like that. And it gives it that authentic feel because, you know, everything up until a few years ago, to give it authentic feel, it's Jim Ross and Jerry Lawler.
I'm sure the video game company could still make a deal with him.
They could. It'd have to be approved by Vince, and I don't know what. And yeah, you're right. They could make an independent deal with him. Absolutely. Whether Vince would want that, I don't know. I would think he wouldn't stand in front of it. But then again, I wouldn't think he would have fired him, right?
That's what I think. Yeah. When you told me the story, I was skeptical that he would actually be fired.
Yeah.
Because I just thought when all is said and done, I mean, obviously, if this is the reason he's fired, it's going to get out quickly. And at the end of the day, I mean, they're not going to look good because, you know, if they fired Ric Flair, it'd be like, okay, I get it. He hijacked the press conference. That's one thing.
But, you know, even with Ric, yeah, I mean, again, it was different. But at the end of the day, you know, sometimes things happen. And again, if the people who put it on, okay, the people who put this on, this was not a WWE event. The people who put on the event, they liked what they got more than what they were supposed to get because somebody went off script and made it. You know, some people might say it was embarrassing, and some people might say it was more entertaining, but they thought it was more entertaining, and they got more publicity out of it for the game, which was the key to the whole thing. So, you know, again, not trying to play, you know, I mean, these two sides have to work together and are going to work together no matter what. But, I mean, I think that one of the things was if your partner who you sent these people to was not only not upset but actually happier with the finished product, at that point, the fact that, you know, it wasn't exactly what you scripted. And again, the whole script thing is a weird one because, again, none of those guys on the panel knew that, you know.
Yeah, but this is not just kind of going off the script a little bit. I mean, he just took over the whole thing.
Nobody was told what it was going to be.
They have never been cool with guys going into business for themselves, even if it gets over. Zack Ryder, well, I realize,
yeah,
is
yeah,
a...
Yeah, you're right about that.
And once you let Flair do it once, you can't use him in a PR role because he's going to do it every time.
Well, okay.
That's what I think.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, I still don't have any idea what anything has to do with Jim Ross.
Well, yeah.
Except that Vince McMahon likes to fire Jim Ross. That's all it is.
Evidently so. I mean, you would think... I mean, I don't know the dynamics that went down. I mean, I know Stephanie went in there and, you know, apologized, which, you know, only made it worse because that, you know, that called attention. When it was over... I mean, when it was over, nobody was really...
Just like your TV gimmick?
Yeah. But, I mean, the thing is, you know, at that thing itself, I mean, there were people who kind of, you know, were talking about Ric. And again, I mean, then there were people who were negative about Ric. I'm not trying to say that everybody but those three, you know, thought that Ric did a good job and that it helped the thing. But when it was over, you know, what called attention to the fact that, you know, as far as to the people who were there... That something went amiss was because Stephanie went in there and apologized.
Oh, she apologized to the video game people. All right, I was confused. I thought she went and apologized to Jim Ross after he'd been fired.
Oh, God, I have no idea.
Okay. It was just raw flashback.
I don't know what happened. I don't know what happened today.
Yes, they apologized after the 2K14 thing.
But, I mean, they apologized that night to the people there, and those people weren't feeling insulted that they needed an apology. But that's It's a different issue, I guess. But, yeah, as far as I suppose that if we're looking at what's going to happen, I would think that coming off of that UK thing that, you know, he'll probably try to do what Mick Foley's doing, you know, with the traveling around, going to the cities, telling the stories. And you know, the reviews of the UK thing were generally good. Obviously, there's one story that I hope he never tells again, which was the dog story. Yeah. And I guess since I just brought it up and most people, you know, obviously didn't see the show, now I have to tell the story. And so anyway, the deal was is that when he was young, his father, I mean, I guess what they raised dogs, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so they raised dogs and he accidentally let the male dog into the pen where they mated with the mom and they created these inbred dogs that they couldn't sell. And the father made Jim Ross essentially kill the dogs as a lesson. And he, you know, this was one of his lessons of life. And, you know, he never made that mistake again. And he even noted that, you know, you could never do that now. You know, it's a different world. This would have been, you know, Jim Ross was born in 52. So this is probably in the 50s, probably I'm guessing late 50s, perhaps early 60s when this story is taking place. But you know, well, I just remember reading that thing, and then people who heard the story, it was kind of like that was like the uncomfortable moment, and that's like the one where I don't know about telling that one, but like I said, aside from that, his stuff, you know, that at least based on the reviews that I read, went over really, really strong. So I think that he'll be doing that. And I mean, as far as what else, I have a feeling a lot of offers will be thrown his way. But I do expect that, you know, by the time the network comes around, that he'll be brought back in some form. But who knows? I mean, retirement's a weird. Well, you can always. It's wrestling. People always come out of retirement, right?
That's right.